بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ثم أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله تعالى وأحسن الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وبعد. Then that introduction that you just heard was something which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would quite often begin his sermons and his addresses with. It is referred to as the khutbatul haja, or the sermon of need. And he would make this address due to what it contains of guidance and due to what it contains of direction for the one who is about to hear it, or the one who hears it. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he would praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that deserves to be praised. Likewise, he would seek refuge in the evil of our souls and the evil consequences of our evil deeds. He would continue by saying, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided, then there is no one who can misguide that individual. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguides, meaning that that individual chooses misguidance for themselves, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases them or allows them to be misguided, then there's no one who can guide that person back to the straight way other than Allah. So we believe that both guidance and misguidance is in the hands of Allah. However, a person who chooses misguidance for himself after the clear evidences have come to him and after the revelation has reached him, then Allah will allow him or her to continue upon that path of misguidance. After that, the Messenger of Allah would recite certain verses from the Quran, and then he would mention, indeed, the best speech is the speech of Allah, meaning the Quran. And the best guidance and example for the whole of mankind and jinn is the guidance and example of our Messenger himself, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would say, the worst of all affairs in this religion of ours are the newly invented matters, i.e. in regards to worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Newly invented matters in regards to the worship of Allah. For every newly invented matter is an innovation, i.e. a bid'ah. And every innovation is misguidance, and everything which is misguidance leads astray to the hellfire. That being said, then the topic of today revolves around one of the pamphlets or leaflets that one of our brothers, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him, compiled. And it's referred, and it's called, or it's entitled, The Seven Fundamental Questions About Islam. Obviously, we live in a time now where there's a lot of turmoil, there's a lot of confusion, that which we see in the media and that which we hear coming through the media is obviously quite disturbing. And there's images which are disturbing, things which cause the heart of the believer to grieve, and also at the same time, things which cause the believer to become angered. Because in one aspect, there are those individuals who are ascribing themselves to Islam, who are the internal enemy, if you wish, because they ugly the face and make the face of Islam, the true face of Islam, seem somewhat disfigured. And also we have those who are the enemies of Islam, who take benefit in the likes of this behavior to further their hatred for Islam. So the Muslim sometimes can find himself caught in a catch-22 situation where he himself wants to make clear the reality of Islam and the beauty of Islam, and no doubt Islam is a beautiful way of life, the most beautiful way of life, as we will allude to. But there are barriers that have become, or there are barriers that have, and obstacles that have erected themselves now, that one has to tear down before he is able to present the beauty of Islam in our time. So when the non-Muslim, or even the new Muslim, or even someone who has not been upon the worship of Allah, even though they may have been born into a Muslim family, wants to now revisit the religion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is met with a lot of dilemmas. He doesn't know which way to turn, who to trust, who to take from. What is the true definition of Islam? And no doubt there are many notions out there who try and in trying to describe what Islam is. So it is important for us to try and clarify that affair so that we know exactly what we are actually talking about. In clarifying the affair, it is important, as we mentioned, to remove those doubts and those speculative ideologies or thoughts that surround Islam. One of the most popular that we find today, when you ask or when you hear those describing Islam, they will say, Islam, it means peace. This is a misnomer. The reality of the terminology Islam, which we'll go on to explain, does not mean peace in and of itself. No doubt, when a person establishes true Islam, as a result of establishment of that true Islam, he will feel peace within himself. And he may spread that feeling of peace to others. But that is not the definition of Al-Islam. Likewise, you will find those who will say that Islam, it is a social economic structure, for instance. Again, this is not the definition of Islam. Even though within Islam, there is no doubt a social economic structure that brings about the benefit for mankind and justice for the whole of mankind. No doubt that is present within Islam, but that is not the meaning of Al-Islam. The meaning of Al-Islam, as the scholars have explained, هُوَ الْإِسْتِسْلَامُ لِلَّهِ بِالتَّوْهِيدِ وَالْإِنْقِيَادُ لَهُ بِالطَّاعَةِ وَالْخُلُوصُ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ وَأَهْلِهِ. This is the definition of Al-Islam. It is submission. Submission to the will of Allah with tawheed, i.e. to single out Allah alone as the object of divinity and worship. This is the meaning of Al-Islam. Submission, total submission to the will of Allah and singling him out with divinity and worship. That is the meaning of Al-Islam. Likewise, it is al-inqiyadu lahu bit-ta'ah, and to yield and to submit oneself to him with absolute obedience. Absolute obedience in every single aspect of one's life. Every affair of one's life. But the foundation of that is the belief that a person possesses in his heart, that he recognizes that nothing or no one or anything of the creation deserves the rights of the Creator. Nothing of the creation that no one or nothing has the right to be worshipped and submitted to and yielded to in the same fashion that the creator of the heavens and the earth, Allah, deserves. So it is submission to his will by singling him out alone with those rights that only he deserves. Likewise, to yield and to submit to him in obedience. Not only that, in opposition to that, it is to remove oneself from ascribing any partners to him likewise. So not only do you single him out alone, but you also at the same time do not share any partners with him whatsoever in that worship. To stay away from that and likewise its people. And this is the meaning and the definition of Al-Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, in clarification of the affair of worshipping Allah alone, say, قُلْ إِنَّ الصَّلَاةِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَا وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوْلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Allah says in the Quran, say to them, O Muhammad, indeed my salah, my prayers, and my slaughter, and my living, my very living and existence, and my dying is for Allah, the Lord of the worlds. La sharika la. We don't ascribe any partners to him whatsoever in the above. Not in our prayers. We don't direct our worship to him, or to anyone else, sorry. Neither do we slaughter for anyone else. And our very living and our existence and our death is for him alone. And we don't ascribe any partners to him in that. And this is what I have been commanded, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with, to say. And I am the first of those who submit myself as a Muslim to Allah. So no doubt, when we explain the terminology Islam, by default, you will understand what is a Muslim. A Muslim is one who believes in that which we have just mentioned, and submits himself or herself to Allah alone. The term Islam is not a term which has, like other ways of life, that it is not, it is not named after the so-called founder of that religion. Neither is it named after a tribe. Neither is it named after a place. Neither is it named after a particular region, but rather the term Islam has a meaning. So you'll find, for instance, Buddhist. The one who follows Buddhist or the Buddhist religion is named after the founder. The Jews or the Judaic religion, named after a tribe. Christianity, named after the title of a person, i.e. Christ. Whereas Islam doesn't possess that particular trait. Rather, the term Islam is not something which has been named after someone or something, i.e. by way of a place or a person, but rather it is a terminology which has a meaning in and of itself. And the word Islam cannot be translated into any other language. The word Islam is a word that has a specific detailed meaning, and that is the meaning that we have brought earlier. So, the Muslim is the one who submits himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Most High, and he calls upon him alone. And this is the methodology and the way and the religion of all of the prophets and messengers. This is the methodology and the religion of all of the prophets and messengers that have been sent by Allah to mankind from the time of Adam all the way up to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon all of them. And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent 124,000 1,000 prophets and messengers to the whole of mankind, since the time of Adam up to the finality of the prophets, and that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we speak about al-Islam, or when we clarify to al-Islam, we need to explain to the people and to those who are interested in Islam that this is the religion and the way of life that was chosen for mankind by the Creator. This is the religion that was chosen for mankind. Allah says in the Quran, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-Islam ad-dina. Allah says, this day have I perfected for you your religion, and I have completed my favor upon you, and I am pleased to have chosen Islam as your religion. I.e., I am pleased to have chosen submission to myself, submission to me, total submission to me, as your religion. And so, in effect, all of the prophets and messengers were Muslim. All of the prophets and messengers were Muslims. Because in reality, every single prophet and every single messenger came with the same call. Ani ubudullah, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Worship Allah. Worship Allah and single Him out alone in regards to your worship. That is the religion that every single prophet, and that is the message that every single prophet came with. So the Muslims are not restricted to any particular land. They're not predominantly Arabs, as you may, you know, you hear many people say that the Muslims or the Islam is an Arab religion. Rather, the greater majority of the Muslims are not Arabs. They come from different walks of life, different lands, different places around the globe. And in reality, even though the messenger was sent to the Arab nation, his mission was to the whole of mankind. His actual mission was to the whole of mankind. Whereas those previous prophets, they were sent to either tribes or a particular location or a particular group of people. But the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was sent to the whole of mankind and jinn. So, in reality, Islam is the singling or the sole worship of Allah, and to avoid idolatry. The avoidance of idolatry. And idolatry can come or can manifest itself in many different forms. That a person, it is not necessary that a person submits himself or prostrates to an actual idol or a statue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَى. Have you not seen the one who takes his own desires as a god besides Allah? As an idol besides Allah. He takes his own desires, meaning that he places his opinion, places his thoughts, places his feelings above and beyond that which Allah has commanded. So when the command of Allah comes, he puts himself, his intellect, his own ideology, his own thoughts before that of the revelation itself. And in reality, he has made his own intellect, his own desires into an idol that he worships instead of Allah or along with Allah. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive. Allah will never forgive that a person ascribes partners, whatever that partner may be, whether it be a physical entity that one, or a tangible entity that one can physically touch and see, or something like the intellect or one's own whims and desires that is non-tangible, that a person places that and worships that over the revelation that has been sent. It is important to understand then the Lord that we worship. Who is Allah? Who is this Allah that we have been commanded to worship? Then Allah is the one who has described himself in the Quran such that we may know him. He has described himself in manners and ways such that we may draw close to him and have attachment to him without necessarily seeing him. Because Allah has not made it something that will occur in this world, that he will be seen in this world. And from an aspect of belief, from the characteristics of the believers, is as Allah mentions in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, those who believe in the unseen. This is from the key characteristics of the believers. And so when a person wants to seek or go out in a path, upon a path, and traverse a path of seeking the truth and finding out what the truth is, he has to discard those preconceived notions that he may have, those bias that he may have in regards to what the truth really is. An example of that is like an individual who says to himself, if there is a God, then in my opinion, this God must be merciful, which is fine. Or he says that I must be able to see this God. For me to believe, then I must be able to see him. And so he places a barrier between himself and the truth by way of this preconceived notion that he has concerning the Creator, that he puts restrictions upon the Creator, his own man-made restrictions in regards to how he perceives God should be. So he says, if there is a God, then he must be able to be seen, for instance. And so he blocks himself from attaining the truth because of this principle that he has laid down for himself. But from the characteristics of the believers, is that they believe in the unseen. And Allah is in the unseen. And no human being or jinn will see Allah in this world, in this life. Rather, that is a reward that Allah has set aside for those who believe in him in the hereafter. But he has made us know him and allowed us to recognize him by way of his descriptions. He has described himself such that we know him and we draw close to him. If I were to describe, for instance, a particular place, a place of beauty, a place that has, for instance, a beautiful sunset, and beautiful gardens, and beautiful beaches, and the flowers and the plants and the trees within that garden and in that place are beautiful. Automatically, even though you have not witnessed that place, it causes the heart to desire to want to see it. Causes the heart to a desire to want to see that place and witness that place. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a similar vein, has described himself such that mankind may know of him. So he has described himself with characteristics and attributes and names, lofty characteristics, lofty names, beautiful names, beautiful characteristics, so that mankind may draw close to him. From his names, and the greatest of them is Allah, i.e. the one who deserves to be worshipped, the one who deserves to be worshipped alone. Likewise, from his names is Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, that he, Allah, is the most merciful to his creation, all of his creation. He provides for them, which is another name, Ar-Razzaq, that Allah is the provider. He has provided for mankind and likewise the creation, and he provides for them everything that they need, from water, from drink, from air to breathe, from clothing, from parents who look after them as a child and nurture them. Every single need that mankind has, Allah is the one who provides that for them. Every drop of rain that comes down from the sky, every vegetation that comes up through the earth, then Allah is the provider of all of that. Likewise, from his names is that He is Al-Khaliq, that He is the creator of every single thing that exists. From His names is that He is Al-Malik, the owner. He is the owner of every single thing that exists. Everything that we can imagine that is in existence that we know of, and also that we don't know of, He is the owner of all of that. So Allah describes Himself so that we are able to desire to worship Him and want to draw ourselves closer to Him, because He is the irresistible. He is Al-Qahhar, the one who one cannot but desire to want to know and draw close to. And there are many numerous names that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained in a hadith where he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ تِسْأَةً وَتِسْعِينَ أَسْمَى مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ, that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there are 99 names. Or from the names of Allah, from the numerous names of Allah, there are 99 particular names. Whomsoever memorizes them, safeguards them, worships Allah by them, by way of these names, then he will enter into paradise. Whomsoever safeguards and preserves these names and worships Allah by them, then he will enter into paradise. And that is a promise from our Lord, as the Prophet ﷺ has explained. But the affair is not just merely memorization of those names. So he mentions Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, and so on and so forth, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar. And he memorizes, it's not merely an affair of just memorizing the names, but rather it is memorizing those names with an understanding of those names, and worshipping Allah by way of those names. And the one who knows those names in reality is an individual who is close to his Lord. So he will not utter a word that is against his Lord, or he will not utter a word that he knows will bring about the displeasure of his Lord, whether he is in public or whether he is in private. Because he is aware that his Lord is As-Sami'. He is aware that his Lord is the All-Hearing. And so whether he is in public, it is not the people that he fears. Or whether he is in private, he knows that his Lord is the hearer of every single word, every single sound. There is not a sound from amongst the sounds, except that Allah is the one who hears it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears the crawling of the black ant, or the creeping of the black ant on a black stone in a moonless night. And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sees that ant and He knows its very movement, because He is all-seeing. So the believer, he worships Allah with that. Worship Allah with that knowledge that Allah is the all-hearing. Worships Allah with that knowledge that Allah is the all-seeing. There is nothing that escapes his vision. And this inculcates in the heart of that person, in the heart of that slave, a fear. A fear that could never be instilled into his heart by anyone other than Allah. The fact that a person knows, for instance, that he is being watched 24/7, and he has been listened to and heard 24/7, always, constantly, places in his heart a fear that could never be instilled in him by anyone or anything else. Not by a human being. That level of fear, that level of khawf, or that level of humility, and that level of recognition and presence of heart that could never be instilled in the heart of a human being by anyone other than Allah when a person knows and he fears Allah to that degree. He knows that his Lord is the all-seeing. He knows that his Lord is the all-hearing. He knows that his Lord is the one who is all-knowing. There is no secret that could possibly be hidden from him. Imagine a world wherein everyone was upon that. Imagine a world where the people submitted to their Lord in that manner. Crime would be out the window. There would be no crime, or there would be very little crime. Or crime would be pretty much non-existent. There would be no need for these CCTV cameras everywhere that we turn. Why? Because you are dealing with a group of people now who have submitted themselves to a Lord that they know sees and hears everything. And their fear is not mankind. Their fear is not, you know, the implementation of a law because the probability that they may be caught or they may be found out. But their fear is because, or their action and their behavior is because they know that there will come a day when everything that they have done upon this earth will be questioned about. The Muslim is one from the teachings of Al-Islam is that he believes in Allah in this way. Likewise, from the pillars of Al-Islam, after bearing witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah alone and that Muhammad is the messenger, likewise he has been commanded with prayer 5 times a day. And this 5 times daily prayer is such that the believer or that mankind does not forget the remembrance of his Lord. He is constantly in the remembrance of his Lord from the time that he wakes up to the time that he goes to sleep. In the morning when he wakes, he has been commanded with a prayer. And just in case he may become forgetful, as mankind no doubt is and does become forgetful, he knows that there will be another prayer which will command him or will force him upon the remembrance of his Lord, the 5 daily prayers. And they are set out throughout the day so that it is almost impossible for mankind to forget his Lord. That forgetfulness is difficult to actually be there because the way that the prayers are situated. The way that the prayers are situated throughout the day, it is very difficult to forget. Rather, it would be something of someone intentionally, stubbornly turning away from the prayer. Stubbornly turning away from the prayer. Because if a person was upon the remembrance of his Lord throughout the day, 5 times a day, almost impossible to forget. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded the believer with the 5 daily prayers. Likewise, he has been commanded with giving in charity from his wealth, that he purifies his wealth he purifies his wealth by giving in charity from that which Allah has given him as a blessing upon him. Likewise, the fasting in Ramadan. He has been commanded with the fasting. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykumus siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Oh, you believe, fasting has been prescribed for you, just as it was prescribed for those who came before you, with the hope or so that you may become God-fearing. So this fasting is a means of attaining piety, that you abandon that which is normally made lawful for you by way of food and drink and by way of cohabitation with one's spouse. That you abandon that, and it places within the soul discipline. Places within the soul discipline that you are abandoning that which is normally lawful for you. Normally, it is lawful for you to eat and to drink and to cohabit with your wife or your spouse. But in that month of Ramadan, you safeguard yourself. You protect yourself. You establish yourself by way of discipline, self-discipline, and stay away from that which Allah has commanded you to stay away from. And if you can stay away from that which is quite normally lawful for you, then it makes it even more easier to stay away from that which is impermissible for you. Staying away from that which is lawful by choice, then by default, it makes it even more easy upon the soul to stay away from that which is, or that which has been prohibited. Likewise, from the pillars of Al-Islam and from the teachings of Al-Islam is the pilgrimage to the house that was established for the worship of Allah alone, and that house that was built by the Prophet Ibrahim, the Prophet Abraham, for the purpose of singling out Allah alone in worship, in prayer and devotion to Him alone. So these are from the pillars, or rather from the fundamentals of Al-Islam. Likewise, there are pillars to Islam. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained, or rather as it occurred in the famous hadith or tradition of the Prophet, peace be upon him, where the angel Gabriel came in the form of a man, of a human being. And he came with his hair being extremely black and well-groomed, and his garments being extremely beautifully white and clean. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting in the company of his companions. So he came, Jibril came, and he sat down in front of the Prophet, peace be upon him, placing his knees in front of his knees and placing his hands upon the thighs of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he asked him a series of questions. He asked him, what is Islam? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described and explained, Islam is that you witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah alone, and that Muhammad is the final messenger, or the messenger, and to establish the prayer, and to give the zakah, and to fast in Ramadan, and to make the hajj to the house. And he responded, indeed, you have spoken truthfully. You have given the correct answer. And the companions that were sitting, they were amazed at the fact that somebody would ask a question and then affirm the answer to be correct. Then he asked him, then inform me, O Muhammad, what is Iman, or what is true faith? He responded, true faith is to believe in Allah and the angels and the books and the messengers and the final day, and to believe in the divine decree or the pre-decree, the good and the bad thereof. So as far as belief in Allah, then it is to believe, as we have mentioned, in His names and His attributes, and to believe in His existence, and likewise to believe that He indeed is the Lord and the Creator and the Provider and the Controller of every single affair, and likewise to single Him out alone in our servitude of Him, in our worship of Him. As far as it relates to belief in the angels, then the belief in the angels is likewise again to believe in their existence, to believe that they are a creation that are in the unseen, and they carry out the bidding or the works of Allah and the commandments of Allah. They are a creation that do not disobey Allah whatsoever. Rather, they do exactly as they have been commanded to do. And this is from belief in the unseen. We believe in it. The angels are, or they have, different tasks and different duties from them. As we mentioned, the angel Gabriel or the angel Jibril, that he is the messenger or the angel that has been instructed with or entrusted with the revelation. And he is the one that brought revelation to all of the messengers and the prophets. Came with and has been entrusted with that job. Likewise, we have the angel Mikael, the angel that has been entrusted with the vegetation and the rain. Likewise, we have the angel Israfil, the angel that has been commanded with the blowing of the trumpet or the horn, which will signify the beginning of the Day of Judgment. The Prophet ﷺ said about this angel that the angel Israfil has already placed the trumpet or the horn to his lips or to his mouth, and he has tilted back his head, and he has pursed his lips, waiting for the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Waiting for the command of Allah. So when Allah gives the command, he will blow upon the horn, and that will signify the day of judgment. So the angels are those who carry out the commands of Allah. From them likewise is the angel of death, the angel that is entrusted with taking the souls of mankind. And taking the souls. That is his duty. That is his job. And there are many other angels that we have been commanded to believe in. Likewise, from the belief, or from our belief, is that we believe in all of the messengers, as we explained, that Allah has sent numerous messengers to mankind with the one and same call, and that is to single out Allah alone in worship, commanding mankind with it. So this revelation that has come from Allah, and you will see that these aspects of Iman, all of them have a connection. So we believe in Allah, and we believe in the angels, and we believe in the books, and we believe in the messengers, and we believe in the day of judgment, and likewise we believe in the divine decree. All of them have a correlation. Belief in Allah necessitates a belief in the unseen. And Allah has commanded those who were in the unseen with a particular duty and a message. From them, as we mentioned, the angel Gabriel was commanded with, and given and instructed with revelation to bring that revelation in the form of a book. And those books that he brought were given to their respected messengers. Those messengers were commanded to call their people to the worship of Allah alone. But there was something that every single one of them instructed and informed their particular people. They informed their people that there was going to be a day when every single one of you will be judged. And you will be made to stand in front of your Lord on a day that you will be called to account for that which you did upon this earth, whether it was good or whether it was bad. Which leads us on to the affair of belief in the divine decree. That everything that occurs in this world, the good of it and the bad of it, the good of it and the evil thereof, was something that was known to Allah and is known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the belief in the day of judgment leads on to the belief in the divine decree that everything that occurs in this world, good or bad, is something that Allah already knew would take place. And so mankind is without any excuse. And he will have no excuse on that day in regards to that which he did in this world. Did you believe? Did you single out your Lord? Did you turn to him alone? Did you single out and specify your deeds for him? Or did you share those actions for other than him along with him? So from the belief in Al-Islam, It causes mankind to really reflect upon himself. Reflect upon his own personal status in this world. And this recognition that he alone will stand in front of his Lord and give account for that which he did in this world is paramount to belief in Allah. It is intrinsic and fundamental to our belief in Allah. When you know that you are going to have to stand and give account for yourself, that which you did in this world, it makes a person really ponder upon his own existence in this world, i.e. his purpose behind his life, or the purpose for his creation. What was I created for? How did I get here? What is my purpose in life? Many people, unfortunately, even though they may sit and ponder upon this question, and they may ask themselves that question, many of them don't know the answer. They don't know the answer as to what is the purpose behind my life? What is the purpose behind my creation? For what was I created? So you find them putting forth all different sorts of solutions. You know, the purpose of life is just to have fun, for instance. The purpose of life is to go out there and to be good to fellow man, they will say. And no doubt, being good to fellow man, being good to humanity, is a good thing. No doubt. But is that the purpose of life? Is that the actual purpose of your existence? Just to be good to others? Or is it that you have been created for a purpose which is more superior than that? You will find individuals saying, you know, I think and I believe that if I don't do any harm to others, and I don't even do harm to myself, I don't drink alcohol, I don't smoke cigarettes or other than that, I don't cause any harm to myself and to others, surely this is a good life. What's wrong with that? But the question is, what have you done for the one who placed you here? And is that the criterion that the one who placed you here wants from you? That you merely do good to others? What have you done for your Lord? What has he stipulated that he wants from you? Has he placed down any legislation that he wants from you? Or is it just the case that he wants you to be good to others? Rather, Allah has commanded that you single out him alone in worship, that you turn yourself and submit to him completely and totally with your heart, with your heart and your body and your soul, externally and internally. Not just outwardly performing acts of worship like the prayer and like giving in charity and performance of Hajj and helping others, but also internally, that your heart is in the complete ubudiyyah and servitude of him. That your heart is in the complete servitude of him and of him alone. That is what Allah wants from you. That is what Allah has commanded for you. And it is not that Allah is in need of that. Rather, mankind is the one that is in need of that. Because by doing that, and by performing acts of worship, you yourself fulfill the purpose of your creation. You yourself become a better human being. You do not become a perfect human being simply by aiding others and not having aided yourself. You do not become a better human being, and being a perfect human being is not merely by aiding others, whilst you have not aided yourself. Because aiding yourself is to submit. To submit yourself to Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Because he ultimately is the one that will judge you. But that necessitates belief in the fact that you are going to be judged. If you are in denial of him, i.e. like the one who claims to be a so-called atheist, claims denial of the creator of the heavens and the earth, claims that he doesn't believe that there's any God, then in reality, this life means nothing, and it was purposeless, and that his creation or his existence had no meaning. Everything that is in existence has some purpose. Everything that is in existence, whether we know it, its existence, or we know the purpose of its existence, or whether we don't know it, every single thing has some purpose. Whether it be a blade of grass, whether it be this pen, whether it be a book, whether it be a building, every single thing that has been made, even by mankind themselves, nobody makes something not to serve a particular purpose. A pen has a purpose. A car has a purpose. A glass has a purpose. A book has a purpose. Every single thing that is in existence or that is created by mankind himself or made by mankind, he would say that I made this for this particular purpose. But when it comes to himself, i.e. human being, he says, I have no particular purpose. My purpose is just to have fun, or my purpose is to perform this or perform that. And he may put forward many different reasons as to why he thinks he is here. Not knowing that his purpose in life is to worship Allah alone. Inshallah, hopefully, we could go on. From the other question that I mentioned upon this leaflet, he mentioned what is the Quran. And in brief, the Quran is the book of guidance and the finality of the books that was sent to the whole of mankind. And it is the uncreated speech of Allah. The uncreated speech of Allah. And that is important. It is the actual speech of God Almighty. It is important to understand this. Because if we believe that it is other than that, then we may compare other speech with this speech. We may compare other speech with this speech. And when we compare the speech of others, we believe that we can take it or leave it. It is something that we can take or leave. There must be some discrepancies within that speech because it is the speech of creation. However, the speech of Allah is not up for this type of judgment, i.e. that we can take it or leave it. The Quran or the revelation is not something that we can take or leave. Rather, we have been commanded with total submission to it. Because it is the speech of the most wise. It is the speech of the all-knowing. It is the speech of the one who created you and knows more about you than you know about your own self. He is the one who made you. He is the one who created you. And so, when there is something wrong with you, or that you are feeling that there is something that needs to be cured, he is the one who has the cure for that illness. He is the one who has the cure for that soul that he has created. He knows about that soul. He knows what is good for it, and he knows what is bad for it. He knows that which will cause it harm, and he knows what will bring about benefit for it. And so the commandments that he has placed within this Quran are for the benefit of mankind. And when a person turns away from these commandments that are in it, he will bring about detriment for his own soul. He will bring about the detriment for his own soul. So all of the commandments that are in the Quran, all of the legislation that are in the Quran, all of the prohibitions that are in the Quran, all of the advices and the wisdom that are in the Quran, they are for the betterment of mankind. They are for the betterment of mankind. The betterment for his soul. The betterment for his environment, the betterment for his economy, the betterment for every single affair, the betterment for the women, the betterment for the men. Everything that is found within this book is for the betterment of the creation. And when a person or when mankind turns away from that, that is when you will find corruption in the earth. You will find corruption and misguidance and oppression in the earth. It is upon every single person to read this book, to read this book, whether he believes in it or not. Because even those who have not ascribed themselves to Islam, have not submitted to Islam, if they were to read it with an open heart, they would recognize that this is not the speech of a mere mortal. This is not the speech of a human being. This is not the speech of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not the speech of a human being. They will recognize that this is the speech of one who is supreme, one who is divine, one who has superior knowledge, supreme knowledge, knowledge which clearly, when a person reads it, knows that this is not the words of men. It's not the words of a man. So this Quran, it leads towards that which is aqwa. It leads towards that which is better, and that which is straight, and that which is sound, and that which will bring about rectification for the soul, both internally and externally. Hopefully, inshallah, I hope that I've clarified something of the leaflet that we mentioned, and hopefully maybe we can clarify better by way of maybe some questions and answers that revolve around what I've mentioned. If there are any non-Muslims present, then I would advise them with reading into Islam, reading the Quran, finding out literature about, or reading literature concerning Islam, and asking about Islam, asking about the Muslims and what they actually believe and what they actually don't believe. You know, unfortunately, in our time, it is quite easy to become misled by that which we have seen and that which we see in the media, such that a person may see a Muslim and believe that this is a religion of bloodshed, and this is a religion of murdering and killing, and this is a religion of oppression of women, and this is a religion that if a person enters into it, he will become fanatical, and he will become a person who becomes an enemy and someone who brings about harm to the rest of mankind. And nothing could be further from the truth. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent to the whole of mankind as a rahmah, as a mercy to the whole of mankind. And he indeed was the prophet of mercy. If you knew about the messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, you would not believe that he is, as these people claim, an oppressor or a person who came with, you know, a religion of bloodshed. Rather, he is the messenger of mercy. And the religion of Al-Islam is a religion of mercy. And Allah is a Lord of mercy. He's a Lord of mercy. To the extent that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah said in a hadith that Allah said that indeed my mercy overwhelms or supersedes my anger. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, likewise the Prophet said that Allah, when he made mercy, he made mercy into 100 parts, or he made mercy in 100 parts. One part he gave to the whole of the creation. To the whole of the creation. One part. One part he gave to the whole of the creation. To the fish that are in the sea. To the mothers and the mercy that the mothers possess in regards to their children. And how they are, how merciful they are to their offspring. To the extent that the Prophet ﷺ said that by way of this one portion of mercy, you see the animal raise its hoof or raise its foot from its young, from not treading upon it. One portion of 100 portions is what he gave to the whole of the world, the whole of the creation, the whole of the universe, one portion. And he kept 99 portions with himself. And these 99 portions, he will met this out and give this out to the believers on the Day of Judgment. So those crimes that you committed, those sins that you committed, those acts of disobedience that you committed, it is hoped that Allah, from the portion, the 99 portions that He has with Himself, will give you something of that. And these portions, these 99 portions, are similar to the portion that He gave to the world, or even greater, to the whole of the creation. So imagine, on the Day of Judgment, as you will come, as the Prophet ﷺ said, there will come a man on the Day of Judgment, and he will have 99 scrolls of evil deeds. 99 scrolls of evil deeds, each scroll being as far as the eye can see. Each and every single scroll being as far as the eye can see. And bear in mind that on the Day of Judgment, it will be an open plain. It will not be like we see today, obstructed and obscured with trees and mountains and buildings. No, rather, the horizon will be as far as the eye can see. It will be an open plain. This man will come with 99 scrolls of evil deeds, each single scroll as far as the eye can see. And this man will feel that he is destroyed, that he is finished. And Allah will say to him, do you have any good deeds? He will say, no, by your Lord, I have no good deeds. And he will think that he is destroyed. And it will be said to him, rather you have a good deed. And on this day, there will be no injustice. There will be no injustice on this day. So, his evil deeds will be placed upon the scales. On the Day of Judgment, our deeds will be weighed. And his evil deeds will be placed in one side of the scale. And then it will be said, rather you have a good deed. And then there will be a card or a bataka, a card that will be presented. And it will be placed on the other side of the scale. And it will cause his evil deeds to shoot up due to the weight of that one card. And when it is looked upon, when the card is produced, upon it, it will say, La ilaha illallah. It will say, La ilaha illallah. I.e., that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. This man, with his evil deeds and his numerous evil deeds, had a belief in his heart, made a statement at a stage in his life that he bore witness to the fact that none had the right to be worshipped except Allah, and because of that he was forgiven. Extensive mercy, a Lord of mercy. This is the Lord that we worship. This is the Islam that Allah sent the Messenger of Allah with. Mercy, not oppression, not murder, not killing unlawfully, unlawful killing, taking the soul that a person has no right to take. That is not Islam. That is those people who have gone to a lunatic fringe. They have gone to extremes in the name of Al-Islam. In the name of Al-Islam, they have gone to extremes. Rather, Islam is a religion of mercy. But ultimately, it is a religion of submission to the will of Allah. That is what Islam is. Submit yourself to Him, and by way of that, He will enter you into gardens beneath which rivers flow for eternity. And whatever you desire by way of good, you will receive. In it is that which no eye has seen, and no mind, no human mind could possibly perceive. There are rivers of milk and honey and wine and water, houses, mansions built out of gold and silver, cemented with musk, beautiful gardens for you to reside in for eternity. And all of this simply because you singled Him out alone. You worshipped Him alone. You submitted yourself to Him and to Him alone. And because of that, He will reward you with the greatest of rewards. That is Islam. That is what Islam has to offer. No doubt all other religions claim that they have this same offer, i.e. eternity, paradise, bliss. They all claim this. But the reality is that Allah only gives this to those who have recognized His rights, fulfilled His rights, carried out and implemented His rights in this world, even if it be with small actions. Each and every single one of us have different abilities. Some of us have greater abilities than others. But so long as you recognize His rights by way of worship and servitude, then He will enter you into His garden, enter you into the paradise, and you will remain and reside therein forever. Hopefully, inshallah, Allah will make us from them, and that one day we will be able to enter into the paradise likewise. And inshallah, hopefully, that is, you know, something by way of a reminder for myself and for yourselves. Allahu a'lam, wa bilay tawfiq, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad.